Welcome to Stormcast, the official Warhammer Age of Sigmar podcast.
I'm Wade Price, wanted by witch hunters for a different crime in each of the mortal realms. Today, I sat down with background writer and Black Library author Nick Horth to talk about how to create fiction and background set in the mortal realms. Hi, Nick.
Hello.
Thank you very much for joining us today.
That's fine. It's a
pleasure. Taking time out of your busy schedule.
Yeah,
as a background writer and sometime Black Library author. Your day job is background writer,
it
right?
It is, yes. So battletomes, codexes and battle boxes and all that good stuff.
All that good stuff.
Mm.
From an Age of Sigmar perspective, what would we have seen your hand in recently?
Recently, this is where I struggle to remember everything that we've published.
In the calendar year 2018.
So I think the Legions of Nagash
counts.
The calendar year.
Book of the Big Man.
Night Vault. Did the background for Night Vault.
I
did the background for Shadespire.
Yep.
The original one. So I wrote that and other things.
Other things.
Yes.
Other things.
It's so hard to remember what you've worked on. It just instantly disappears out of my mind.
On to the next thing.
Yes, exactly.
Your brain must be filled up with the next year's stuff and the year after that, probably.
It's a constant struggle to remember what is being released and what is out. So essentially, sometimes I walk into the shop and I'll be like, oh, I wrote that. I didn't even realise it was out, but I wrote it.
How have you got this already? You're not supposed to know about this. It must be nice to exist in that kind of constant surprise and delight.
Yeah, it's really cool.
Games Workshop stuff.
It's nice knowing, kind of anticipating how people will react when things that come out and then seeing that happen. But it does take some getting used to kind of being so far ahead.
Yeah.
And then, because obviously some products... the lead time is massive, and sometimes it's a bit shorter. So, it's always a nice wake up call when you go in the shop and see what's out.
It's happened. It's real.
It's real.
They didn't lie to me. We made this thing.
I didn't dream it. It wasn't a fever dream.
I always find, because we're recording this in December, and I always find this time of year, my brain really struggles to remember what's coming out next December, or what's like. There's a kind of 18-month. Mess of the future in my head. So let's not talk about the future. That's fine. We'll stay on safe ground. We'll talk about the sorts of stuff that you have worked on. So how long have you been with the design studio now?
So I've been here for about 3 years, coming up to 3 years. It might be past 3 years now. I started out as a fiction writer, oddly enough.
And that is an interesting starting point, because you were hired to write fiction as opposed to battletomes or army books.
Yeah.
But you do write battletomes and army books.
So, I did that job for about half a year, maybe more, before I basically transitioned straight into the background writing team, which was a nice smooth, a bit of a weird kind of course correction, but it was a very welcome one. I've been doing the background work for 2.5 years now.
So what's your background in the hobby? What attracted you to come to work in the studio in the first place?
So I used to play when I was 14 or 15 or so. I was never a massive hobbyist. I was much more into the books in the background. Mm-hmm. So I've just got one of those minds where I occasionally just get obsessed with a setting or something. I have to know everything about it. So I actually owned loads of codexes and things without actually playing that much. It was just reading Dan Abnett novels and things, Graham McNeil, Aaron Dembski Bowden, that kind of got me back into it, just about, I would say about after I around the time I was in uni. So I ended up reading a lot of Black Library stuff, and that was how I got into the fiction side of things initially. Just sent off an application out of the blue, and for some reason they accepted it. I still don't know why, but and then obviously being around the studio then,
lots of talented people to
exactly. It's very exciting.
So had you written any kind of speculative fiction up until applying for that, or did you decide I'll write some words and see if I get a job?
I wrote a story about dinosaurs when I was about 26.
It's still on the fridge.
When I was at school, I wrote a lot.
Yeah.
And then I didn't really do much until I sent off that application. It was a spur of the moment thing. Like, it wasn't something I definitely planned to get into writing. I didn't know what I wanted to get into after university, but I've always liked reading and writing. So it kind of felt like a natural kind of, I just thought, I'll go for it. What's the worst that can happen? They're not going to phone me up and laugh at me down the phone. apparently it was good enough.
Yeah, that's what I'd say. So. I don't know, I've chatted to Sam Pearson before today and in the past about his experiences of applying for jobs at Games Workshop. His story was very much applied, didn't get through, applied, got a bit of feedback, applied, got to the next step, got some feedback, worked on it. And occasionally you talk to people whose story is, I applied for the job I wanted and I got it.
Sounds awful. It's so arrogant to say that. But
There are fewer lessons or moral principles maybe to be drawn from Sam's story, from yours.
Yes,
from
yeah,
Sam's story.
It's two different approaches.
Yeah.
I think I applied for a couple of... I sent in, you know, when they had the open window for fiction, I think I sent in a few things before I went to the actual position. So I had done some work towards that, but that was really the only writing I'd done. And then obviously after getting the job, do write every day.
Yeah,
do loads of writing. So yes, I've not stopped since. But
where do you think you might have ended up if you hadn't applied for the job?
Oh, God knows. You know, in a canal. I don't know. Probably something quite different, I would imagine. I was in that sort of position where I didn't know what I wanted to do next, so I have no idea what I would have ended up doing.
So a lot of people who finish university with the degree that they picked years before go, I don't want to do this.
Yeah.
What's this?
Well, I did film studies, which I love. I love doing, and I ended up doing some freelance games journalism stuff when I got out of university.
Cool.
But I never thought it didn't seem like a career.
Not like writing about grots and goblins.
Writing about goblins is what you want to aim for. So yeah, it was kind of out of the blue, really.
Cool.
Yeah.
And what was the first thing you wrote?
So the first thing actually would have been Shadows of a Hammerhole.
Wow.
I think that was the first, very first thing. So that was, for anyone who doesn't know, is a board game, a Warhammer Quest game, and there's also a kind of source book with it, which actually has some narrative fiction telling the stories of the characters from the box. So that kind of fit in with, you know, what I was doing. I think I wrote that actually while I was working as the fiction writer.
Okay.
And then, but it sort of crossed into the background position as well. So, yeah.
I remember you writing some of the text in the Gangs of Kimura game.
Oh,
well,
yes. Yeah.
But
yeah.
Different game system, wrong stream. We can mention that if we bring you onto Voxcast. Maybe.
I think there was some there was some fiction in that as well, as far as I remember, which was a lot of fun to write, actually. Makes me want to revisit Drakari at some point. But anyway.
Nice. Cool.
Yes. Yeah, so that was the first thing, I think. And then it was City of Secrets, my first big project, I guess. Yeah.
And I think we've had a few chats on Warhammer Live. You come on to Warhammer Live to talk on some of the Age of Sigmar Wednesdays about world building, really, some of that big picture highfalutin stuff that you'll have done quite a lot of across these different projects set in the Warhammer Age of Sigmar mortal realms. I think we'll probably talk a bit about that over the course of the
sounds good to me,
because it's good fun.
It's
and
good
I think
fun.
The projects that you've worked on, when we look at just looking around the shelves around us, you said you'd worked on the Season of War Firestorm. You worked on both Shadespire and Night Vault. They creating the settings for those places, did you have complete free rein to come up with the background for those places?
Yeah, as far as I know. So obviously it depends on what the project kind of brief is. So I think for as far as I remember, for Underworlds, Dave Sanders, who did the rules for that game, had an idea that he wanted to, basically the way the games worked was that your fighters would respawn or would have, you know, they would come back on potentially. So you had to have, we were trying to find out a way of getting around that problem of fighters reappearing after they'd been killed, and how could we fit that into the narrative? So that's what led to the Mirrored City and Shadeglass being a sort of cursed city where everyone can't die and continuously respawns, to use very video gamey term. But so that's an example of, we had a very broad brief, and then we kind of we focused on that point and then kind of developed the idea from there. I think Firestorm, we knew we wanted to set it in the Realm of Fire because it's one that we had explored. So sometimes, like, you'll know from the start, there'll be a firmer idea of where we want it to be set or what exactly we want it to be about. So that one, I think, was quite quite specifically, we knew what we wanted to do is create some new free cities, Sigmarite cities. But then everything else was, in terms of where we wanted to set it and what we wanted those places to be, was kind of free reign. So yeah, it's you often get a huge amount of freedom to do what you want. to go mad.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Within reason.
Within reason.
Sanctioned madness.
Sanctioned madness, yeah.
And then games like Warhammer Underworlds, Night Vault, Shadespire. Mm. Shadespire is now this book over there.
I know, it's
like,
crazy.
Other people are then going writing. How does it feel to see other people writing about places that you've created like that?
Still slightly surreal.
Yeah.
Like to see the novelization, or that it's not a novelization necessarily of the game, but like something set in that world is really cool. Because yeah, it's a really interesting task when you have a limited amount of background space to set up something that has kind of a depth that people can then, you know, explore and play with. So that is very satisfying to see, and then to see people, you know, doing their custom kit bashes and things that's still awesome.
I think
still
when
a great feeling.
Shadespire first came out, I was aware shortly after seeing people building kind of model or three-dimensional boards and really taking to heart all of the background, the imagery. And as I say, there's not a huge amount of space. It's not like you had a novel that was packaged with the box that would tell you the entire history. You have to try and get that information in. For the people who really want it, because I guess for a new style of game like Warhammer Underworlds, there'll be plenty of people who just go, yeah, we fight best 2 out of 3. That's fine. I don't necessarily need the story. But the game requirement has compelled you to come up with a great background reason. And I can also imagine it must be quite satisfying to know that then that is a conceit or a trick that could be deployed in the future if there is a need to. If there's a Warhammer game, we could set it, or we could set more Warhammer games in that sort of place.
Yeah, absolutely.
That setting.
Yeah, I mean, it's 40K and Age of Sigmar, both, you have those things where you'll seed something in one book, and just a throwaway line, and then you'll suddenly discover to your delight that you can that fits seamlessly into another idea that you have, or another story that you're telling. So you can slowly sort of expand and build upon these things, and I think that is what's so satisfying, especially about Age of Sigmar, because everything is so new, and we don't have the established kind of traditions and places, and is building those and watching them grow. So yeah, hopefully Shadespire, you know, that concept, you know, will be extrapolated upon and might turn up in other things. So that's really exciting. Yeah.
Did any of those themes come up? You said you worked on the Legions of Nagash Battletome and bits of the Soul Wars.
Yeah.
Were any of the elements of that referenced in the background?
So funnily enough, so we had the idea for Shade Glass was essentially this substance that could store people's souls, which is why they're all trapped. And I think it was pretty much happenstance that Phil Kelly was working on the core book for Age of Sigmar 2 at the same time, and he was playing with the idea of the Realm Stone and exploring the realms in more detail. So the idea that Shadeglass is actually vitrified Realm Stone, grave sand from the Realm of Death, then becomes a major plot point in Malign Portents and building up to Age of Sigmar 2. And there's a few other things in there as well that, in terms of the location where Shadespire is set, that ends up being a location that we look at a little bit in the core rulebook. So it was very much a case of that, of people looking at what has gone before and then, you know, expanding on it. So yeah, there are a few things, considering it was very much like an isolated project when I started working on it, to see it, you know, being, as I say, expanded upon is it's very cool.
Who's to say what it could look like in 20 years' time?
Who knows? I still want to see some cataphranes in, you know, to, I think those guys are amazing. If I say so myself.
Indeed.
I have considered modelling some, like doing a bit of a custom job for some of those guys, but my talents are limited in scope. So, yeah, who knows?
Have you got any Age of Sigmar hobby projects on yourself at the moment?
Oh, about a million.
Oh, good.
So I'm very much flighty, a flighty man. I was meant to be doing a Slaanesh army of Wrath and Rapture out soon. But then that got sidelined to do an Ideneth army, which then I started, then it became Caradhron. So Caradhron is the thing at the moment. And I've got far too many things to build and paint, but I am thoroughly enjoying painting some Caradhron. I flip between things. The only thing I stick with, weirdly, is Gene Stealer cults, but I don't know why that is.
Something in the water.
Something
in your blood.
I'm infected, clearly. Yeah. But so I guess Caradhron, I'm trying to get to 1,000 points of Caradhron for a nice kind of smallish army, and then see where we go from there.
Would you use I know the term hobby butterfly is used by people to describe someone who moves from one project to another. Hobby magpie is something I've heard more recently. Which
hobby
seems
moth, just hobby banging moth myself relentlessly
against the bright light of whatever's newest and most exciting.
That's an accurate way. I need to learn some hobby discipline, surely.
And what attracts you to these armies? Is it the background or the miniatures? Or
it is usually the background that I come from. Mm-hmm. Like, I think both the Carajon and the Eidneth in particular, it was reading the Battletomes, which I didn't get to work on, sadly, but are just amazing. And both of those have a really cool, unique, very Warhammer-y concept that feels different from your typical fantasy armies. I think they've both got that really a really fun character to them.
Mm. They've both got things from the sea in the air.
Yeah,
like boats or fish. Is that the common thread?
What I'm talking about. Yeah. I also have a thing about guns and low tech in fantasy. Mm-hmm. I like the idea of a corn berserker running at you and you shoot him with a shotgun several times. That's fun.
Yay.
So that's why I like
berserkers, character. But I can see how you might be attracted
to
that.
I'm so sorry. It's fine. I didn't mean to pick on them.
No, I know.
But yes, a mixture of the two. And then the models for Age of Sigmar are always amazing as well. So yeah, it's very difficult to... That's another thing, when you work in the studio and you know what's coming and you see what's down the line, it becomes an absolute nightmare of worrying about, oh God, right, I want to get these guys finished, but I know I've got to prepare for these, and never ends.
No, it does give you weird kind of targets and timelines. You go, I'll start this project, I only need to finish it in 2 years' time, because that's when the new plastic whatever is going to come out, and I'll just paint this existing stuff. 2 years is a long time to get distracted by any number of other projects that are coming on.
So blessing and a curse.
Well, we can't really ask you, I guess, for any advice on how to stay the course then, because it sounds like...
I'm the worst person to ask that question of. I think if it always helps if you set yourself goals, that's the thing I don't, is that I just occasionally go to the shop and buy something and then paint it. I don't, because I'm not a... I play a lot of narrative. I play narrative more than I do match play. I think match play gives you a structure when you're collecting armies that... you don't necessarily have when you're a narrative focused player. So just get it all. Cool. Enjoy it. Worry about it later.
Do you have any backstories for any of your armies? Is there anything that you're working on at the minute, or are they...
So the Carajon Force, I am going to I went paint scheme first rather than clicking off a backstory, but I'm definitely going to do that, because just there's so many cool things in the battle tome that I want to get across.
Do you have a theme for the army? Is there an idea for it beyond Sky Pirates?
Sadly, no. That's a terrible answer from someone who's meant to be a background writer.
It's fine. You don't have to have written the story. You don't have to complete a novel to have been writing a book, or to have been a published novelist, in fact.
I usually do cook up backstories for everything I play, but I started with the models first this time. The paint scheme first, and then we'll see where it goes. But
that's an entirely fine way to collect miniatures.
It's a valid choice.
Right, that's equally valid as liking the miniatures or looking a bit to the background. That's fine.
A mix of everything, I would say.
So you have written a few different types of Warhammer Age of Sigmar publications, I guess, battletomes, novels, source books. What do you think are the qualities of the Mortal Realms? What sets Warhammer Age of Sigmar apart from other fantasy properties?
So I think the scale of it is one thing. The amazing high fantasy scale of it. I really like the idea that we can zoom down to the little guys in the cities, but we also have literal gods wandering around doing their thing. And I think because they're all personalities that we have got a history, there's a lot more weight to the struggles between those gods and the factions they represent, which is really exciting. And also it is the idea that we are on the ground level of the IP, in that we're it's only been around for three years. So to see something develop like that is really exciting, and it's just such a vibrant setting as well. I think obviously there's still a lot of things to develop, it's just really, really vibrant and colourful, but it still has that Warhammer grittiness and dark humour to it as well.
So it feels like you can do anything as a creative as a writer. You can do anything with the appropriate levels of Warhammer darkness.
There's a lot of freedom, and as you say, you can do anything, but there is still a theme and a kind of character to it that ties everything together, if that makes sense. I think it yeah, it's just really exciting to work on a developing property. Mm-hmm. It's great.
And you talked about conflicts. We mentioned conflicts. Mm. I guess conflict is a topic that will come up in an awful lot of things set in the Mortal Realms or the Warhammer Age of Sigmar background. Do you find that there are any themes that develop when you're talking about conflicts between the different factions or the Grand Alliances? Is there a story of Warhammer in that regard?
Yeah, I think so. I think even in amidst the Grand Alliances, you have all these, you know, you have all these fractures between those powers, which is really interesting to dig into. Like, you know, none of those guys are really the good guys. Yeah. None of them are really, well, there are some bad guys. But I mean, I think everyone has that depth to them.
That's very judgmental language for you to say, Nick.
I apologise to Nagash, our Lord and Master, who is a really great bloke. So that's really exciting. I think telling stories going forward of it not being separated into good and evil necessarily. Like, everyone's got their own flaws and motivations and things, mm-hmm. and you can kind of understand them. You know, you have real tragic figures like the Eidoneth who are horrible, but also there's a tragedy to them. And likewise with the Stormcast Eternals, I mean, they are awesome heroes, but again, there's the cost of what they're doing. Mm-hmm. I think that's really exciting.
Do you have any particular favorite factions to write about?
Typically I like grunts, guys on the ground. So I like the your average Joe Average with his gun.
Two feet of clay.
I like writing about free guild and free cities. But I also, it's really hard because they're all so fun to write for in their own way. It's like I've written some Caradron stuff now and that's great. Like the mercantile, you know, very pragmatic view on everything they have and their kind of reliance on technology. I just love that. I think that fits into the universe in a really cool way. Destruction's always fun. I haven't answered your question there.
Okay,
no, I can't. I'm a writing butterfly as well as I just don't like to make any choices.
I like to try to trip people up with that question. Most people I ask are experienced and well-versed enough to go, I like all of them. I like all of the things that I might be briefed to write a book about or sculpt or draw a picture of next week. I like all of them equally. They're great.
They're all equal. I like them all.
Do you find that there are opportunities to write, well, there must be opportunities to write different sorts of stories. I guess if you're talking about the free guild, that's the kind of the basic human, and you can present the mortal realms through their eyes. And I guess most of your readership are humans. You might not have exhaustive survey data. You've got a few beasts out there. But most of them would be humans, you'd imagine. So you can present the mortal realms from the perspectives of another human.
Yeah.
And that's got to be quite a useful way of presenting it. You need to understand how the Dwarden mind works, which I certainly don't. I've read books, but I can't claim to have an affinity with the Dwarden mind. But
I think that's cool to have that ground level perspective. And then, but yet, like you say, you end up doing all sorts of different things. I mean, when we were writing the Malign Portent short stories, obviously some of them are set, you know, some of them are very ground level, but others, we got the chance to zoom into all these different perspectives, like vampires, like sort of hidden in the societies of the cities, you know, Nurgle worshippers and how the, so every time you write a battletome or you write anything, you always get to experiment with new things, which is really cool, and new perspectives and new kinds of, almost like new genres of writing.
Yeah.
Like we definitely tried to, with Malign Portents, ramp up the horror element a lot more. That's exciting. Because every battletome you write, there's a slightly different focus on it, I think. So you never get bored.
And I guess every battletome is also an opportunity to acknowledge or look at some of the other factions, because the battletome wouldn't just talk about it. Warhammer Age of Sigmar doesn't leave any faction a life without conflict or battle, so you're going to read about who the subjects of your book are in combat or conflict with, and that must give you an opportunity to look at the perspectives that different races have on the other races.
Yeah, it's always fun, even things like timeline entries and things, when you get to just mix and match and try and think about what would draw these two factions into conflict with each other. So that can lead to some really interesting places as well.
And it's not always conflict, I guess. There's a lot of conflict, but there are opportunities for alliances and the Death Grand Alliance, the Destruction Grand Alliance. You get to zoom in, having talked about Legions of Nagash.
Mm.
Nagash is certainly involved and keeps a good close look on the legions that bear his name, but that's part of the Death Grand Alliance, so that you can imagine how the different factions or the sub-factions within the Death Grand Alliance would interact with the legions or Nighthaunts.
So that was a really fun thing about writing that book, is it? Because you think about Death as a monolithic faction, Nagash at the top, and everyone is following his lead. But within that, you do have these interesting rivalries and sort of personal motivations. Like his Mortarks, with the exception of maybe Arkhan, are all pursuing their own ends as well.
Mm-hmm.
They just got to do it in a kind of sneaky way. Like Nagash is a god, and he has godlike power, but he's not entirely omnipotent. And although he can bend his generals to his will, you know, they're still going to be able, while he's busy, you know, on the million other things he's doing, building big black pyramids, for instance, above the Nagash's are.
Important work.
So they're all trying to sort of get away from under his thumb, or to you know, swell their own power at the expense of their rivals or whatever. So digging into that was really interesting, and thinking about the vampires, for instance, how do they, not typically known for enjoying being, you know, under some skeleton dude's will, so it's how do they chafe against that, and that's really interesting. I think that's like that gives depth a lot of depth as well. So yeah, the idea is to, so we get to a point where all these factions have those interesting little divisions within them, mm-hmm. and those things, so it's great for storytelling.
And did the work that you did on Legions of Nagash, that must have allowed whoever it was who worked on the Nighthaunt Battletome to bring about Lady Olinda, because you'd created, well, there were three existing Mortarks at the miniatures for when Warhammer Age of Sigmar first came around, and Nagash was presented as the Supreme Lord of the Undead and the leader of the Death Faction. Had you had any inkling about possible future Mortarks when you were working on that book? Was that something that you knew might come along?
No, not really. I mean, I think we all always knew that there were likely to be more Mortarks, because it's just the way Nagash, you know, he
one in each book, right?
He has a contingency for everything, so he has all these, you know, irons in the fire. So we knew that was a potential thing.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I believe that I didn't, when I was writing Legion of Nagash, that was before we'd really seen anything of the Nighthaunt. I might have had access to a few early concepts or something for them, but yeah, really we were, that book, yeah, followed on. So it wasn't like I wasn't laying down the groundwork for that. No. But yeah, keeping it open enough that,
yeah,
which is always something you've got to do. You never want to close corners when you're writing something, because you never know what's going to be around the corner, especially in Age of Sigmar where
anything could happen.
Anything can happen. So yeah, it's an interesting challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I think one thing you always end up doing is leaving yourself, is making sure that there's plot hooks and plot threads to pull on. And it's always useful, because when something new does turn up, then when we read back through what we've already written, there's always ways you can root it into the world and make it feel like it's already been there.
Yep.
So that's an interesting challenge.
There's work I know that's still happening in Warhammer 40,000. People are combing through 30-year-old references, going, we could do something with this. Like this, if you look at that now, in the light of what we know now, this could be taken to mean something very different. There's got to be a whole lot of work to be done with Age of Sigmar in seeding those, and not excitedly reaping them before they're
too
established.
It's a really interesting challenge. Like we constantly in the studio when we're developing the story, like we're aware that we've only got, you know, 4 years of history for some of the places that we've developed. Mm. So it's a question of, you need to give those things time to bed in before you can't get into the situation where you're always throwing all your toys, breaking all your toys when you think of something exciting, because you have to. It's a really interesting blend of wanting to have consequential things happen, but also building up really slowly and patiently that sense of history and tradition. So that's an interesting challenge. And like you say, it's surprising even with the initial core rulebook or the Realmgate Wars books, like how many of those things are slowly, you know, being drawn on now for what we're writing. So yeah, that's a really exciting, it's almost the opposite of, as you say, it is almost the opposite of writing for 40K in a lot of ways.
You're going to plant stuff and just leave it.
Yeah.
Leave it, but also create stuff that you can write about and active right now and let people think about and engage with, because an awful lot of like timeline entries or historical accounts a lot of the time they're included so people can be inspired to go and do something much like that themselves. But sometimes you might want to just leave an idea. You know, don't touch it. Don't play with it. Just let it take root.
Yeah, sometimes you have to kill your darlings, as the phrase is, so you can have a great idea for something. But it's not always the right decision to use that, whether it's a setting or a character or something that's been established. You have to know when to play your cards and when not to. So it's always an interesting challenge, but a fun one.
Yeah, the peer reviewing process in the studio. Do you have to be upfront with what your darlings are? Do you have to let people know? I've put something in here, and I'm blind to it now. I need you to let me know if this isn't the right time for it, or do you just try and slip them in and see if people can spot it themselves?
So I think peer review, we usually operate on the... So if something's pulled up multiple times by many different people and saying, that's clearly wrong, don't do that, I think obviously you take another look at it.
Yeah.
But I think it's knowing when to trust your gut, and because you can get some feedback, and feedback is not... it's a mutable process. You know, not every suggestion that someone else has,
you can always ignore feedback.
You can always choose to go your way, but it's a constant dialogue with your team, because it's that feedback doesn't come on in a document only. You know, we're always having IP meetings and things and chats around these things, so I think we typically always get to a really good place with that sort of stuff. But sometimes you do have to take the red marker out, unfortunately.
Just leave it to maybe get in next time.
Yeah, maybe save it. Maybe save it for another day. Yeah.
So what does your typical working week look like? How would your time in the office be broken down in stuff that you're working on or looking at stuff that other people are working on?
So it changes so much. Depends what's going on, because we have a lot of meetings, obviously, in the office for different projects. Often you'll be sort of... You'll have a project you're working on, but you'll kind of be also... putting the finishing touches on another project that you've just handed in, or you'll have other things to do. So it can be quite... it's never you sit at your computer and you write exactly what you plan to write for that day, because something always, you're always being diverted or something. So you have to kind of be able to roll with the punches, or that sounds very negative. You know what I mean?
Be
adaptable. That's the better way to describe it. So we make sure we fit in reading over each other's work, and making sure that we, which is always really difficult, keeping up to date with everything that's been published, because, so many battle tomes come out in boxes, and it's really important that we know exactly what we're talking about with all of those, of course. So there's some time for research and things. If you're approaching a new project, often you try and get at least a week of researching everything that's gone before, and coming up with sort of planning out what you're going to write and stuff.
And people would just leave you alone to read things for a week, right?
Well, sometimes.
Best will in the world.
Often not. It's constantly changing in a really interesting way. So every week is a new and exciting challenge.
Yeah.
That sounds sarcastic because I have a sarcastic voice. But
we should also specify, after pulling back from the roll with the punches, Nick definitely doesn't get punched in the office. We should just...
help me. No, I don't.
Warhammer Age of Sigmar Design Studio does not punch Nick Horth.
No, that's never happened again. No. Not since the first time.
Draw a line under that scene. That'll be fine. So the background that you've created for the realm, or we've talked on Warhammer Live about creating... background, a bit like you've talked about for Shadespire and locations within the Mortal Realms. One of the things that we talked about on Live was about the realms themselves, how the realms are not necessarily just the most obvious thing. And we've talked about that with regard to making scenery or creating a background for a particular location. I thought that was an interesting thing that could be further embellished. The example that you gave, I think, at the time was the Realm of Fire isn't just fire. There is fire in the Realm of Fire.
Yeah.
The fire is also available in other realms. But the Realm of Fire is that passion and emotion. I thought that was an interesting thing that we could talk a little bit about, just for the benefit of anyone who hadn't clued up on some of that sort of stuff before. What are some of the less obvious influences? That's probably not the right word. Manifestations of the different realms that you can think of.
So I guess to pick one... So Haish is the realm of light, but it's also a realm of illumination and invention. So it's not just big glowy towers. Yeah. You know, the whole realm has that kind of sense. The magic of each realm is as much, you know, it generates, it's hard to describe. Yeah, like you were saying, like with the realm of fire, everything's passionate and fiery. In the realm of life, everything's about cycles and regrowth and rebirth. Mm-hmm. So that's not just to say that everything is green and plant-like, mm-hmm. although it, obviously a lot of it will be, yeah. but there's a constant cycle that's going on there.
It's and evergreen.
Yeah, yeah. And whereas the realm of Gur, the realm of beasts, is about conflict and predation mm. and it's constantly changing. So yeah, I think the realms are nearly infinite, and we don't want to say that the realm of fire is all volcanoes. Yeah. All volcanoes, mate. A couple of molten rivers. Mm. It's how the landscape is affected by that kind of character mm-hmm. of the magic that it's formed from. So yeah,
and then you get, I guess, a bigger list of words to pick from or choose from if the realm of fire is more than just flame and fire. If you're looking for the appropriate words for artifacts or places within the realm or yeah. people from there, you get to use some of the words that would relate to some of those other adjectives and build up your pool of available words as a writer, which yeah. must be handy and avoid repetition. And
yeah, exactly. I think what we want to avoid is, we talk about this when we're writing battletomes, is when we're creating, you know, storm host equivalents for tribes, for Bray Herds, for Beasts of Chaos or whatever. What we don't want to do is get in that position where one is the fire one
yep.
and one is the leafy one.
Yep.
Because it's a bit reductive, so it's thinking about how that the nature of that realm manifests for each race, mm. and it can be quite different, yeah. Which makes it a lot more exciting. Because then, as you say, with things like artifacts and spells and things, we're not always just going back to the same font, mm-hmm. and we can come up with new things.
The illuminating hat,
exactly.
The illuminating sword.
But yes, the spectacles of Shaish.
Shaish,
not Shaish. That'd be awful.
Yeah, just see death. You'd yes. see dead people. It'd be no good in that at all.
You'd just go to Shaish and you'd see dead people, to yeah. be fair.
So one of the other things that I know you for is the city of Excelsis. I think that's one of the more realised, well, I guess a bit like Shadespire was a very realised city until Nagash came and knocked it over. Excelsis has still got a little bit of a more promising future than Shadespire has. Maybe I haven't read everything that you've written. We'll see.
At the moment, yes.
As things stand. So we talked again a bit about this sort of stuff on Warhammer Live, but how do you go about creating a setting like that that is so richly detailed and established?
So I think generally when we're doing cities in Mortal Realms, we tend to pick one high concept thing that city, you know, that defines that city.
Yeah.
So if you can sum up a city in a sentence, mm-hmm. Then I think that is a great starting point. Mm. So the thing with Excelsis is, I think it was mentioned in the core book, maybe, or possibly one of the Realm Guide books, but all we'd really know about it was that it was in the Realm of Beasts, and it had a shard of Malice, the world that was embedded in the coast outside the city, that was imbued with secrets and prophecy.
Mm-hmm.
And that is that was the high concept. And then we sort of extrapolated on that and thought, if you were to live in a city where there was a big secret rock down the road, how would that develop? How would the city develop?
Mm.
So then you get the idea of prophecy as a kind of currency that the yep. city functions on. So as soon as you have that central concept, you can kind of extrapolate that through all the levels of society and see what happens. So that was very much the starting point. And then from there, this weird sort of economy developed where their coins are called glimmerings, and they mm-hmm. each contain like a tiny sort of glimpse of the future. But obviously, the more money you have, if you happen to be a rich Azerite noble or something, you've probably got a lot of this yeah. Stuff. So there's a sort of self-fulfilling thing there where the rich have the best kind of prophecy, so they get richer and richer and more, you know, more, what's the word, you know, more separate, grow more separate from the poor working classes
yeah.
who have to make do on a single kind of glimpse of the future per day. So that creates all these interesting things to pull upon. And then as you're fleshing the city out, you get a real sense of the character of the city itself. So obviously that has resulted in the nobles being walled off in their own district, essentially hoarding all this stuff, whereas everyone else just sort of manages as best they can. So I think we'd start with a kind of grand central concept, and then kind of, as I say, extrapolate that and pull it apart and try and work out what it means. But it's the same with Shadows of a Hammerhall, I guess, which we knew Hammerhall was a twin city, whereas one half of it was in the realm of fire and one half was in the realm of life. So obviously there's a symbiotic relationship there. Mm. And then it's in a question of, okay, so how does that work? Well, Hammerhall Gyra provides the food for one thing, and the water and everything. So you get that real kind of connection, but a difference still between those two cities. So that's and then I love this stuff. This is my jam, as the kids say. So slowly building on something small and then growing.
And once you've got facts established, like Excelsis being the city of secrets, and there is a trade in secrets, that allows you, I guess, to then kind of zoom out on the map a little bit and go, well, there would be other settlements or people coming to trade with them, and what would that throw up? Would they need to have fortifications to look after the armies that would be guarding the wagon trains or the merchants or whoever?
Yeah.
And plotting out the map that way.
So, exactly. So you get... So the world automatically begins to feel more alive because you have those things. And obviously, that becomes a really strong reason for it to be an important city for the God King to protect.
Yep.
And for the Knights Excelsior, who are the storm host there. Ideally, we want to build those connections between the races, everything. So you can see that the Caradron, for instance, would absolutely love that, would you know, be drawn by those prophecies, because that would, you know, that's their thing.
That's their jam.
Yeah. It's a fun process to do. And you never quite know where it's going to take you either.
Do you have much scope to do more of that sort of thing in what you're working on at the minute?
Going forward, I think we're constantly trying to we want to have those places that people come to recognize, as I was saying before. So I think we're in a good place for order. We have several sort of cities that we can build on and that have already featured in things now. I think people are starting to get to know a little bit. Obviously, it's early days so far, but what we want to do is now extrapolate that and look to the other factions and imagine, you know, what does a death city look like, because we know there are some in Shaiish and possibly beyond, or what does a chaos fortress city, chaos bastion somewhere look like, because these societies have to function, you know. Chaos has been around for how many hundreds of years. They haven't just been rampaging around going bah! And axing everything in sight. So that's really interesting, because then thinking about how does a corn bloodbound horde function outside of the battlefield, and I think that just gives that extra bit of texture to the Mortal Realms.
I love that sort of stuff. I have the Blades of Corn. I mean, you do want to know how do they get from battle to battle without just being a footnote in someone else's timeline entry a vast cornate horde turned up, we had to kill them. They were causing an awful lot of trouble.
Yeah, so I think that's going to be that going forward with Age of Sigmar. That's going to be one thing we're really looking at is. For destruction, chaos, and death is giving that sense, same sense of verisimilitude as order has at the moment.
And would you be looking at it in the same way as a grand alliance is worth of seeing how the different forces of destruction might live cheek by jowl in their hovels and caves?
Yeah, I think so. I think we're getting to a really interesting place with destruction. That's something that is developing. You know, I think people have been starting to look at some of the Moonclan grots that are coming out, and obviously they have their own unique place within the forces of destruction. So I think the more that happens, you know, we will get that kind of as you say, those conflicts between the races, or like how do they exist side by side. So that's really interesting.
I guess there's definitely scope for more races to be introduced to Warhammer Age of Sigmar. It feels like the four grand alliances are pretty set. So if you're looking at how the forces of death interact, or not live together, die together, but if new death sub-factions were added, you can understand how you'd add a new force of ghosts or mummies or whatever it might be to the existing death paradigm, because they all have to not live. It would have been better to stick with the destruction example. But if a new force of destruction is added to the greenskins and the ogres, at least if you understand how destruction stuff works, you can add another critters in there.
Yeah, exactly. I think that's the really exciting thing about Age of Sigmar, is that you never actually know what is coming down the line.
Yep.
Because the Mortal Realms are, as we say, are massive.
Big and light.
And, you know, there's plenty of space to get lost in, or to... you know, some new horrible danger comes rampaging out of the sea, for instance.
It could happen.
You know,
Yeah. There's a feature, I think, of Warhammer Age of Sigmar compared to Warhammer as was, and all of the battletomes can look at a particular faction. You're always reminded, Legions of Nagash, it's part of Death. Nagash has got an involvement in all of Death. Other editions of Warhammer, you might have just been looking at how a particular race or a particular faction exists in isolation, because they did exist. They lived in isolation. They fought off everything else. They maybe grudgingly talked to a few races, but everybody was quite compartmentalized. And Age of Sigmar's not the same at all. We know from the Cities of Sigmar and the big order foundations that elves and Dwaradin and other creatures, I'm sure, of the free people move around within these cities. That does seem to be a big feature of Age of Sigmar, that these alliances do live and fight together.
I think that's really cool. When I was writing City of Secrets, it was important to me that we didn't... So the one thing you don't want to do is just do the old world again, but in a high fantasy setting. Like, everything has to feel different. So I think the idea that we had, the core concept of all the races that have previously been so separate living together, and how they develop, like how that kind of the interactions between those races changes when they are, you know, when they are living at such close proximity is really interesting and just a bit different. And you get to avoid straying too much into archetypal things, like these elves are flighty and aloof, because, you know, they've been trading and living right next to the humans in Dwarden for however long. You know, they're not going to be so arrogant as perhaps they once might have been. So that's really interesting, and it makes it feel, it gives that sense of fusion to the cities where they take on a life of their own, which is really cool. But I think also it's that thing of, as much as we all love the old world, you did get the sense that some factions were kind of on their own little plot.
Yeah.
You wouldn't get a lizardman running around, you know,
Noldorf. Yeah, it would be difficult.
And when you're telling stories, it means that you're limited. The geography and the simple physics limit you, and it means that it's difficult to really get all those armies, you know, in conflict with each other, which is ideally what you want. Mm-hmm. So, the Mortal Realms, having everyone... you know, having these melting pots and have everyone kind of interacting with one another is really cool, because it just allows us to tell more exciting stories.
Mm-hmm. And I guess it introduces a bit of friction even within the Grand Alliances, that somebody's Destruction or Ironjaw's army might have a different perspective on one of the other races or members of the Destruction Grand Alliance.
Yeah.
And you can show that, again, verisimilitude, that sense of real breathing background and factions in there, because not everybody is doing it exactly the same way or how they're told to do it. You've got a freedom as a collector, as a writer, as a general, however you want to interact with the background and the hobby to make your army do what you want to do.
Yeah. I think that's really exciting. Like, you see armies on... Where someone's got, you know, hobby collections on Twitter, pictures of things where people have got that cool concept for their army, and that's just really exciting. So yeah, it gives you a lot more freedom in terms of the character of your person, your own collection, which is really fun.
And one of the questions I've seen writers, background writers and rules writers get asked about the kind of creation of rangers and battletomes, do you get a chance to tell the miniatures designers you should do this, or ask them politely, should you do this? I know that, but there's not a huge amount of opportunity, largely because miniatures are made quite a lot longer before the books get worked on, but I'm sure if there are opportunities to talk to people, they come up.
And I think it ends up being a sort of symbiotic relationship anyway, because you're writing things down in battletomes that then might get picked up by miniatures down the line. So it might not happen for a few years, or it might never happen, but miniatures, you know, are reading the publications as they're coming out as well. So we're kind of influencing maybe the next generation of models. Also, you know, they're coming up with awesome stuff because they know what they're doing. So the best of both worlds, really, when I think we're getting inspired by what miniatures are doing and they're getting inspired by the stories we're telling, and you get into a really cool position that way, where it's just so much creativity flying around.
Well, with all caveats, what kind of miniatures would you like to see? Is there a particular army, or is there anything from the background that you would absolutely love to see? Anything?
So I cooked up the idea of the Aglaraxi in Firestorm, who are kind of mage, sorcerer mages who ruled flying kingdoms. Carradine have slightly stolen the thunder of flying kingdoms, of course. But they were very much like, it was a mageocracy, so they were all the rulers of that nation were all mages, and they came up with all sorts of wondrous creations. They had like awesome fire golem things. They also came up with a giant crystal ray super weapon called the Prismaticon, which is quite fun. So I like that idea. Mm. That's quite fun. I think there's so many things, like so many little details, especially with the work that Phil's done on the core book. I mean, you could read that and come up with 1,000 ideas for new armies. But yeah, who knows?
Who knows?
What's so exciting about it?
And separate from the miniatures, then, that's maybe a dangerous question to lead you down, or caveats for wishlisting aside. we've seen some of the more recent battletomes. They've not had a new miniatures release necessarily, but there's been a great opportunity for the guys in games development to bring a book up to the standard of the latest edition of Age of Sigmar. Is there any one of those older factions or anything from the world that was, or an earlier battle tome that you'd love to roll your sleeves up and get into? And
I think I'd like to work on some Seraphon. Mm-hmm. I am a Lizardman fanboy from the old world, but I also think there's lots of scope for embedding them into the Mortal Realms and seeing how they fit in. Mm-hmm. But just because I think there's a really exciting way directions that we could take, you know, their story, and so that would be amazing. And they're dinosaurs, so as I said, you know, dinosaurs are my thing. So yeah, I think I'd really like to bring them into the Soul Wars and beyond.
Have they featured in any of your fiction?
They have, yes. They do pop up in Silver Shard. I couldn't resist.
I've not read the Silver Shard. Forgive me. I'm not up to speed.
Spoilers.
Oh, spoilers, they're a Seraphon.
Yeah.
You've revealed that now, I think. We can't undo it. Maybe we can edit that one out. We'll see if this makes the final cut. and I guess, what other work have you got ongoing that you can tell us about? Is there anything?
So, probably can't say anything that I'm working on at the moment. I'm working on a few things for Back Library, so I will be writing some more fiction for them.
Very good.
It's very exciting. And lots of exciting things in the studio that literally the cage would come down from the ceiling if I started talking about.
Release the cage. We've asked a few people now, what would your advice for somebody who wants to do a job such as yours be? And the best advice I've heard given to people who want to be writers is write.
Yes.
That seems to be regardless of discipline. You have to write if you want to be a writer. Can you add anything to that for the benefit of anyone who would like to write for Black Library or Warhammer background?
We did start off by discussing by the fact that I did no writing before that I got this job. So, but yeah, that is a good thing. Writing and reading, mm-hmm. and expanding what you read as well, because I think not just reading fantasy fiction, or not that there's anything wrong with that. It's brilliant, but widening your pool of kind of the books you've read, because I think influences can come from anywhere, and I think it just adds more depth and creativity to your writing if you're the more well read you are. But yes, writing, entering competitions and things whenever possible, just mm-hmm. Trying to get feedback on what you're writing, I think is a really important step, because part of this job is learning how to accept feedback, but also realizing that's the editorial process and the peer review process is what makes any writing good.
Yeah.
Without that, it's just nonsense. you need that polish. Like, that's where the magic comes out. So I think that's getting used to having people eyes on your work is probably a good thing.
Some of your biggest learnings as a professional writer? I guess you didn't have much experience as an amateur writer, but what would some of your biggest learnings as a professional in the studio have been?
Plan.
Mm-hmm.
Which I'm still working on. Mm-hmm.
When will you have a plan?
About 2026, cool. I think. Let's sometime.
Having a target in mind, that's probably the first step. There you go. That's good.
So it's maintaining that work rate as well.
Mm.
You know, because you have to kind of. It's all very well writing really good quality stuff, but you also have to be able to function within a kind of ongoing production cycle.
Yep.
So you can't miss your deadlines. And so writing to deadlines and being used to that and being able to pace yourself so you can meet those deadlines is super important. Working with other people as well. I think it's easy to think of writing as a solo job where someone gives you a thing to write and you just sit down and do it. But I think it's such a, the process is always, you know, it's a team job. It's not you can't just sit in the corner and get on with your work. It's, you know, you constantly need to be in discussion with everyone around you, whether that's the artists or the layout guys or whoever, because that's the only way you get the product that, you know, a great product is by making sure everyone's working together. And, you know, that's where a lot of the best ideas come from at the end of the day, is when you're in discussion with the people around you. Mm-hmm. So that's important as well. So yeah, I think those would be my main kind of takeaways from 3 years
you've
of
learned.
Doing this.
You've learning. Yes. That's great. You're changing in front of our eyes.
Grant, I think we're pretty much out of time. So I will thank you again for joining us today. Thank you very much for your time. I look forward to actually getting around to reading The Silver Shard. I've got a copy up there. I'll take it away and have a look over the Christmas. Follow up City of Secrets.
There will be a test.
Good. I'll be ready. I'll come back to you. When will you plan for the test to be?
I'm not telling you.
Okay.
I'll jump out at you at some point and ask you questions.
Like, there's a seraphon in it. Yeah. I know that. I've got an answer ready.
No, I'm not going to ask that because okay. You know it already.
I hope you can come back on the show at some point in the future, maybe when you've written some more stuff, and I hopefully will have read it, and we can talk about that and where we think Age of Sigmar is going to go.
Awesome.
See you again soon. Cheers, Nick.
See you, Wade.